All right, you're asking for it, so here it is.
Listen to this.
Right. Welcome, welcome, welcome to the 171st episode of the Drinking Partners Podcast. Yes, this is a dual athlete episode. It's a David Robinson and Elgin Baylor episode because they are the only two NBA players to score exactly 71 points in an NBA game. Yeah. And they're both all-time players, but very underappreciated in the scope of the NBA history. And I feel like we like that in the city. Like, we out here all time and doing shit. We consistent. We out here with everybody. And we underappreciate it. It's not to take anything away from the fans who show us all the love. You know what I mean? But, yeah. You know what I mean? The city don't have that comedy mystique yet. Yeah. They don't understand what we doing. Like, we out here doing it big,
who
man.
Who has a podcast? What the fuck is a podcast?
They both champions. I feel like we a champion. You know what I mean? I kind of look like Elgin Baylor. You don't look like David Robinson. Like, but I feel like you used to have a haircut like him before you went bald.
Is that the general?
No, he's the admiral.
The admiral.
I'm the general, yeah. Motherfucker. I'm the general. EB the general on Instagram. I'm half of your host in tandem, Ed Bailey. I'm joined as always with my co-host, Dave Bracey. Say what up to the people.
What's good, Drew people?
Two or two.
What's good with you people? I am Dave Bracey. We are the Drinking Partners. And if you're looking for us, you can find us on epicastnetwork.com/partnerspod. You can find us on iTunes, Stitcher, Lipson, and Google Play.
We Googleable.
Under Drinking Partners. You can find us on IG, Twitter, and Facebook at PartnerSpot. 171 episodes, 171. Man. 171 episodes we've been asking y'all. We will continue to ask you. Please hop on iTunes, rate and review. That's how we know what we're doing well. That's how we let others know that we're doing well. And that's how we continue to do well, man. Hey, look, man, 171 episodes, I've been saying that shit. I don't think y'all fully understand. Listen, when you post a review, that really does let the motherfuckers know what we're doing. You know what I mean? Like, they go on, they're like, I don't know, what's this little, you know, what's this podcast? Everybody with a motherfucking a cell phone has a podcast. You know what I mean? Like, you know, so they go on, they see some reviews, and they're like kind of going through or whatever. It lets them know what we're doing. And, you know I mean? It lets us know what we're doing. And it continues, I mean, it lets us continue to do what we're doing well, man. Because, like, you know, like, if without that, we're just another couple of motherfuckers in a basement with some mics and...
I don't even know if this is a basement. This is a cellar. But look, you love us. You tell us you love us in public. Now, at the click of a button, just tell the internet. Tell the world. And look, we love y'all. So we try to give back. You know, people give to us. We love give back. So if you do leave a review, we will read it here on the podcast.
We will read it on the podcast. And we will do that. But if for some reason you can't leave a review...
Yeah,
just in lieu of rates.
In lieu of rates and reviews, we do accept shots of Hennessy.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Shout out to Car Guy DJ and the Conways for starting the trend and keeping that motherfucker going, because I've been out random places and people have, I've gotten random Hennessy. And there's no better Hennessy than random Hennessy. Yeah. But we will read your review on the podcast, much like this here, titled Fantastic, Funny, and Informative. Ooh. By Ty B's or Ty B Easy. I don't know.
Ty Biz.
I don't know. TYBEZ could be a bot. The only reason I don't think it's a bot is there's no numerical representation in that name. Because you know the bots be like Tybez 7234. Yeah. You know what I mean? So they erase it. So there might be a real person.
Yeah.
Tybez or TYBEZ. I like TYBEZ. I like that. TYBEZ. That's probably what that shit is.
Oh, I ain't gonna endorse this until I get a fucking review. I've been
he
burned
a mumble
before.
Rapper.
We've been burned before.
TYBEZ's
a
mumble
before
rapper.
Before I give TYBEZ the endorsement, I gotta hear this review.
TYBEZ got a mixtape out. But yeah. The review is so much dialogue with amazing guests about local issues, and it's hilarious. Thankful for this great podcast, which leads to our podcast, because our podcast, like, yeah, you know I mean, we try to promote the local. Our guest, she's all on top of all the local issues
that's
and things
not a
like
bot.
That. This is not a bot.
He
plus,
be listening.
It might not be a mixtape rapper. Like, no mixtape rapper. Like, I don't feel like Lil Pump is writing a review that uses the words dialogue, amazing, or hilarious. Like, those are three syllables. Lobble words is not.
It wasn't a review that said, yeah. Like,
yo, could somebody please leave that review? Is it chip? And I'll read that motherfucker. Like,
funny like a podcast.
Oh, shit. Yo. Can we get review songs? Could somebody review us in melodic form? That would be dope.
I won't ask you to listen to this podcast, but if you ask me for a podcast, I'll offer you it.
Yeah, and look, Ty, be easy. Please come up to us, man. Show who you are. You know, introduce yourself. You know, we got a show down at Arcade Comedy Theater on June 16th. We're there every third Saturday. We have Alex Tepula headlining, so I'm excited about that. It's the first time he's headlining the Drinking Partner show. Ooh, man, you've been following Alex. He's been doing big things. Yeah. You know what I mean? Him and Race to the Coffin. So hell yeah.
Yeah, rkcomedytheater.com, and we got June 30th, Norlex, man. I mean, the bro, he's coming through headlining Comtra Theater before he headlines Carolina.
Caroline. I'm on that show with him at Caroline's, you know crazy what I mean? Bitch. So we trying to take Pittsburgh to Brooklyn, you know what I mean? Like, he there, I'm trying to bring it out there. I'm trying to blow the fuck up, man. You know what I mean? I'm trying to, well, now it's not blow up no more, it's glow up now. You know what I mean? You don't blow up no more, you glow up now. So I'm trying to glow, unless that's just for women. Do men glow up?
I think there's a glow up for
okay,
men.
Okay, all right, cool. Yeah, all right, cool. I guess it's not. I just, you know what I mean? I ain't one of that fans.
I think when you get to a point, when you almost die, and then you get to a point where you can rock sleeveless motherfucking jerseys.
I literally
and shit.
Died. I did
when
die.
When you get
on
back to a point
road,
where you can rock sleeveless jerseys and shit, that's a glow up, bro. You just had a glow up.
Can
and
I just toot my own horn a little bit?
This last year.
I've been real humble about the action and something, but I do have like little benchmarks that are breaking me, so I am now bench pressing over 200 again.
Yeah.
Back in this motherfucker, man. I'm back alive doing this shit, but just don't tell my lawyers because it fucks up the lawsuit. Yeah. Just don't tell them.
He's still in litigation.
Still in litigation. Nah, man, back, yo. So it's fun, man. Happy to be doing this shit. I'm happy to be here. I'm proud to be doing what we're doing. We still doing our shows. You know what I mean? They're always BYOB. Yeah. We always have a craft beer sponsor.
Yo,
Mindful has volunteered to be a consistent sponsor. Shout out to Mindful.
Shout out to Mindful. If we're doing it, Mindful's going to be there, man. They've provided beer for this podcast. They're providing beer for Arcade Comedy Theater, and they're going to provide beer for Comtra Theater as well, June 30th, with Norlex Belma, the homie. And if you're looking for tickets, that's ComtraTheater.Ticketleap.com, man.
So I got a tagline for Mindful. Wonderful beer and atmosphere. Dope. Book it. That just happened.
They earned that. They won. They're winning.
No, but speaking of people like showing love and sponsoring us, we got some gifts again from our friends at Trogues out in Hershey, PA.
Man, Trogues has been showing a lot of love.
They've been showing a lot of love. Shout out to the
Trogues
brothers,
man. We're gonna talk to them about some sponsorships coming up with Fresh Fest. You know
they
mean?
Can sponsor. Like, I just want to hang out again.
Yeah. I mean,
swag ass barrel
brothers,
room.
And them brothers, man, they come. Them Trogues brothers, man, they are legit, man. They showed out.
That made me feel like we doing something well. Like,
yeah,
we brought them out of their shell. Like, yo, we fucks with you.
Yo,
two
you
guys
know how many motherfuckers came to us. It was like, yo, this might be difficult. They don't like a lot of motherfuckers.
They're not talkers.
Yeah,
like, nah, but this is an interview.
Yeah,
we gotta speak.
So shout out to Trogues, man. They sent us a box and like, I mean, and hopefully we can get them on the sponsorship with Fresh Fest, man. We got so many brewers.
Fresh Fest.
We got so many brewers coming through with
run
this
Fresh
it
down.
Fest. In case you were wondering what Fresh Fest is, it's the first black beer festival in
Get
Pittsburgh, em. Man. You know what I mean? Like, we out here, we got 10 black brewers coming in from around the country. We got 20 brewers locally that are pairing up with black artists and entrepreneurs to collaborate on beers to be presented at the Fresh Festival, man. Like, and listen, man, this is all... This isn't just another beer festival, man. People have been talking about, I mean, hey, why don't you guys put on a beer festival or whatever. It's like, but for what? Why be another beer festival? This is a beer festival that is actually pushing the genre, man. Like, we are, you
pushing
know,
pushing it forward, right?
We're looking at the beer industry and, like, you know, if you've been to a brewer, you typically know there ain't a lot of us in there. You know what I mean? Like, and then, you know, in the
we be in there.
We be in there. We be the only motherfuckers in there. You know what I mean? And then you look at the black brew, like, you know, in the black
shout
culture
out to
or whatever.
Black brew culture in the building.
Shout out to black brew culture. Yeah, you know I mean, co-founder. Yeah, you know I mean, and you know, you look at that and in the black beer culture, like in the black culture, we're looking at the Millers, the old, you know what I mean, the old English or whatever, and they think, you know, that craft beer is hoppy, bitter, bullshit, you know what I mean? And like, look, bruh, craft beer is a $1 billion industry. It's a $1 billion industry.
We want parts.
We need to be in that.
We need parts.
We need to be in it. Speaking of Trogs, you know what Trogs did? Trogs went out in the middle of fucking nowhere. They opened up a brewery and a city developed around that.
Yeah, they were smart too. They was right by amusement park. You know, don't be giving a fuck about getting on them rides.
Motherfuckers wasn't buying houses next to the amusement park.
Real shit.
They ain't start buying houses.
Ooh, that's a lot of swag.
See what I'm saying? They ain't start buying houses.
The property value
until
in this
the brewery came
okay,
through.
Okay, wait a minute.
So if you're looking at Pittsburgh and you're looking at, you know, there's no black middle class neighborhood in Pittsburgh. And if you're looking at actually growing one, I'm looking at Trogs. I'm like, yo, put a black brewery in Pittsburgh. Grow a fucking city around that. Black owned, black operated. Yeah, I mean, black frequented. That generates dollars in the black community. This is what Fresh Fest is doing, man. It's starting that conversation.
Yeah, we got to change the narrative on what it is, man.
Exactly.
Like, you know, you see guys like me and Dave, we enjoy this shit. Like, I mean, we regular guys. I mean, we out here doing it. Like, it's a culture that I've enjoyed being a part of for the past few years. I was not a part of this culture there before starting this podcast. So, you know, I just want that to be out there for the people. Like, people don't know.
Yeah.
I mean, you always say, you know, access, you know.
Access and education, man.
Access and education. So that's what we're trying to bring to the city. So come out, August 11th, Thread Beer, Cedar and Wide, you know what I mean? We trying to do this shit.
Yeah, FreshFestBeerFest.com, man. Check out that. Now, what did Troke send us, bro?
Let's take a look here. Because they be packaging all. They had their own bubble wrap last time. Ooh. Tape and shit. No, they had their own tape, right? But they had their own fucking tape.
This is some frilly, like, can we get some pictures of this? The frilly shit that's in there? I don't know.
Oh, the black and gold?
Yeah, they got their own packet like that.
Shout out to the black and gold with the crimson. Yo, this is the perfect for me and wifey. Like, the black and gold with the crimson, you know what I mean? You know what I mean? Alpha Delta connection. We doing it, you know what I'm saying?
Crimson pistol.
Wifey, this for you.
Elk brew. With hibiscus flowers. Ooh.
I don't even know what type of flower that is, but I'll grow that motherfucker because I can smoke it.
I'll
sound like
shit.
I could smoke it.
Potpourri. Let's sprinkle it on the blunt.
Smoke the shit out of a hibiscus. If you got a cold, then smoke you some hibiscus. I got the sugar. Go ahead, smoke. Roll up some of that hibiscus. You'll be all right.
Shout out to Trogs, man. They showed us love. They've always been showing us love, man. We appreciate them. I mean, so
this
Crimson Pistol. I'm excited for this.
I'm excited for this episode. And much like Trogs, you know, our guest, you know, came into, she was here, but. You know, when the city started to affect change, started to affect the atmosphere, started to affect the surroundings in which she lived.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, at the beginning, we always like to introduce our guests in a certain way. And I came up with something because she was like, I don't know how you want to introduce, because she's humble as fuck. She's like, I don't know how she is. So here's what we'll say. Our guest today, independent as fuck, because she's doing it all on her own. She's doing it with her own words, her own thoughts. She's had her own blog, and now she's got her own episode on Drinking Partners. We want to welcome Virginia Martinez to the Drinking Partners. Say what up to the people.
Hello. Can I just say, first of all, that was the hardest thing I've ever had to do, is sit here and not laugh. You guys,
we encourage it.
You said you didn't know what a hibiscus flower was. I just wanted to tell you what it looked like. I mean, it's just really
tell us
hard
what
to
it
sit
looks
here
like.
And not talk to you.
No,
guys.
Go ahead, you educate us.
Please tell us about these hibiscus.
I know you've seen one. If you go anywhere, they're usually in a tree form, and they're like the pink purplish kind of. You'll see them look like small trees.
I didn't know we could drink them, motherfuckers. Though, see what I'm saying. Like, that's the thing. Like, I might have saw it, but until
can
you tell me
you
I can drink
it?
That, until you can tell me I can get fucked up off of it,
can
like, it doesn't
you
even,
smoke
like,
it?
You know what I mean? Until you tell me this plant can alter
you.
My reality.
Can you smoke it?
Can you smoke it?
I'm not paying attention to foliage. I'm not paying attention to that. Only time I ever looked at plants was I was playing Metal Gear, and I needed that for health because I've been shot. Can you smoke it?
My only green thumb is use the splint blunts. Like, that's
there we go.
As far as my green thumb goes,
Swishers preferred. White owls acceptable.
Green leaves only.
No, but we want to welcome you to the podcast.
Thank you
for that. You know, education.
occasional hibiscus that I still don't know if I can smoke it. But we'll get brew to it. That. We can brew
definitely
it.
Definitely brew. We know we can brew that shit. And it is. This is actually pretty. It's floral and
it's kind of girly.
I'm tasting it in this beer. Like, yeah,
has
I mean,
it ever been a wedding bouquet flower?
I'm sure it has. It's very popular around here, but only in the summer. Like, you can't grow it.
You can't grow shit out here.
No, you really can't.
Animosity.
Now that you know the word, the next time you go somewhere where there's plants, you're going to see it, and you're going to go, oh, and you'll never not see it. It's always going to, it's very common.
I probably will overlook it.
Try,
just because it's growing out of the ground and I can't smoke it. At least I don't know yet.
I didn't say you couldn't. I don't know.
Oh, okay.
My girl is a florist or whatever, and she does all the copy edits. She listens to this, so I'm sure she's going to listen to this and start pointing shit out that she's like, how did...
Oh, did we get you in trouble?
Yeah.
You in trouble? Do we need Buzzy to edit this?
Yeah. I'm
we
got to start over? Like,
all right. Welcome to the 171st episode of the Drinking Partners Podcast. Yes, this is the No Hibiscus episode. We ain't talking about that shit. Not today. You're not getting into that shit today.
Never happened. The fuck is a hibiscus?
So for the listeners who are not familiar, let everybody know who Virginia Martinez is, like what you've been up to.
Montanez?
So my husband is Mexican. So when he first moved up here and I first got married to him, I would pronounce it properly, which is Montanez.
Montanez.
I fucked that up.
You can't. It gets really screwed up.
I got all the way to Spanish 4 and still fucking it up.
It's so bad. Why they got two different ends? We were like, you know what? Nobody can do this. Nobody can.
Montanez. Oh, that's
Montanez. I like that a little better.
I like saying it. I mean, I'm not gonna just say it all. Like the effort that comes into it. That's a toughie.
Nah. Why do they have two different ends in that language? They never explain that.
Okay, that's okay. See, that's the thing. Montanez had the other N with what's called the tilde over it.
That's
so
the tilde?
It's called a tilde.
It's
so instead of
that's what the squiggly is called. It's called a tilde.
Right. I don't know. So without the tilde, it's just the N sound like we have here in English. With the tilde, it gets a Y to it. So it's So Montanez. Nobody can do it.
Can we add that to to the Apple thing? Like I don't have the
there is a keyboard because my husband uses it and it's super annoying because there's two ends. I don't recommend it.
Oh, you gotta hold it and then you gotta scroll over to the other end.
Well, no, it's not where it's supposed to be. So when you're typing, you just screw everything up. Well, I don't recommend it. We got rid of it. I was like, we're not doing this anymore. Yeah. So
then my apologies, no disrespect.
No, not at all. Nobody ever gets it right. I get a lot of Martinez or just any brown name,
Yeah, I pretty much I tried to, and the listeners will probably call me out on this. I tried to just merge what I thought it might be. I just kind of made up a hybrid, and I kind of leaned towards Martinez because people could identify with that. I was like, yeah, somebody spelled this wrong, but no, they spelled it right. So that's
I will say this. I won't say too much though because my husband will be embarrassed. This will tell you in Pittsburgh, with the Hispanic community is really small, so we get a lot of Martinez. Is the point?
Least, yeah.
He went to a medical doctor, and they pulled. It was his doctor, and they pulled the file for a Martinez instead of a Montanez, and he didn't get the right procedure.
Oh.
And it's not the kind of doctor you don't want to give you the wrong procedure.
Oh, it's like Booty Call. It's like the movie Booty Call.
And so
shaved his balls, they switched the thing. Yeah, I'm not saying that's what happened to you, husband, but I'm just thinking Booty Call.
It was like a test type of procedure, and after the test, goodness. He was confused, and the doctor was like, well, fortunately, we're not seeing any of the issues you had last time. And he was like, I didn't have issues last time. And they were like, aren't you David Martinez? And he was...
There's got to be a settlement check.
I'm sorry to tell you, sir, you have sickle cells.
There's got to be a settlement check coming from that. Like, you could have took my temperature. If it wasn't supposed to happen, you got to pay me. Like, it's not supposed to happen. Like, y'all going to charge me for this shit. Y'all going to charge my insurance company.
I don't know whatever happened with that bill, but we get a lot of Martinez.
That's what happened with most medical bills. Who opens their medical bills and let me get my credit card out? No. Nobody does that.
Nah.
I even break the seal on these motherfuckers. I just read, oh, you talk Allegheny Health Network? Yeah. Nope.
You got to find me. You got to catch me out.
You go take my property? You got to catch me outside.
You got to serve me. You can catch me in a parking lot. You better see me on the let out.
So that's my name. Yeah.
Yeah. I apologize. I wanted to get you in here on a more civil situation, but here we are.
It's very civil.
It's civil. Yeah. We're just.
Become a stereotype. That's all. Ed is a stereotype. I profiled our guest and I fucked up, and it happened.
You profiled her with your sleeves out and a basketball jersey.
Okay,
so,
well,
yeah,
now I don't even understand what you're trying to say. You said, where are you going with that? You know, if I was from Pittsburgh, I'd have on an Antonio Brown jersey right now.
That would be a stereotype. And yeah, you are a black man from Cleveland in a basketball jersey. And that's
not just a basketball jersey, but the greatest of all time, LeBron James, the LeBron Raymond James. I'm like, skill. Let me tell you something. Skill. I'm going to do this whole episode as Shannon Sharp. Skill. Skill. Let me tell you. All right, skill. You got the name on the list. You got the name, and then skip.
You know, he is the one person, like, I don't hear well, obviously. I cannot understand a word he says.
I don't know if
it's his lips, but I'm like, is he
you
speaking
what?
English?
You know what?
It's
you know what?
Watermelon.
I can't
his
understand
lips
him.
Have fucking irked me for fucking decades, man. Since he's become a correspondent, I've hated his fucking lips. It gets involved in everything he fucking says. And I'm like, how the fuck did you get this job? But you know what? Since he's got on this, what is it, Undefeated?
He be clean as shit.
I don't even know how he's like, because I don't even listen to him. I never watch his show.
I listen to
Undefeated. But I read his shit, regular. And I like, he has been on fucking, I've been a fan. I hated this motherfucker when he was on, you know what I mean, the pregame shows and shit like that. Why? Like, fuck, because it just, everything he said, but like, it was all lip. It was very true to who he was. It was a heavy southern accent with heavy lip. And I was like, how the fuck? I don't know what the fuck, all of you, but I'm like, man, fuck this dude. But then since I hated this motherfucker. I'm like, fuck. But since Colin Kaepernick took that knee,
right?
Shit, he has been on point, and he got it. Yes. He's on Twitter now.
Yeah.
Shit, he has been on point. So I shout out to Shannon Sharp, baby. Yeah, that motherfucker.
I don't know. You kind of dissed him, kind
of. Yo, it took me. It took me years before I became a fan. Now he's one of my favorite followers, man. So shout out to him. And shout out to you. Like you've made waves. Yeah, I mean, it's like, and it's really so. Like, I mean, in Pittsburgh. Tell us how you got into, I guess in the field of journalism. You know I mean, because I mean, in what you do, and you know, I mean, canvassing the scene and letting people know, you know I mean, what they need to know, that's journalism. And you know I mean, right, tell us how you came to Pittsburgh and grew into that.
Right. Well, actually, I know I have an accent, but I was born here, raised here, but because I have hearing difficulties, I can't really hear myself as well as other people. So it's kind of cool because I don't realize I have an accent. So, but
nobody with an accent knows they have an accent.
You know, it's nice. It's just, it's a deaf accent, I guess.
You don't have the Pittsburgh accent.
No, exactly. Whoa. Yeah. Anybody that doesn't, you know what I mean, call it a Dan Tan. You
know? If I catch myself,
Dan Tan,
I shut that down.
You shut that shit down?
I said I mean, no offense. I mean, my dad has a really heavy Pittsburgh accent. Everything is flyers and tires and shire, and it just
the iron. I definitely do iron.
So thank God I couldn't hear it well enough to pick it up. You know,
yeah. If you don't say that, I just assume you're not from here. That's just if you don't say
it, it's fine. I'm fine with that. I am from here. So what happened was, I started working in the nonprofit world. I actually worked for what was called the Minority Enterprise Corporation, which was helping African Americans start businesses. I did that for 6 years. And I sort of fell into it. I was really honestly a white privilege kind of chick. I didn't really understand anything about diversity. And I ended up working in this Minority Enterprise Corporation. And I learned a lot. I was actually finally educated as to how the world really works, and it's not always the best way. Mm. But when you work in a nonprofit, you get to know the city, the bad, the good, the really, really bad. I didn't have anybody to talk to about that, really. So I started writing it. And I'd always been a writer, because when you don't hear well, you spend most of your time in your own head.
You're like the daredevil of journalism. Man. I mean, you're the other senses.
Why you ain't say that shit? I could have introduced her as such.
Right.
We could have had that. Could have been the open.
let's
daredevil
go with
of journalism. Damn.
That's dope. We'll go with
it. But so I didn't. You know, you're in your own head a lot, and you kind of get a voice. And I don't mean like, you know, like I'm hearing voices. I mean, your written voice comes out. And so I started a blog one day, and it just kind of exploded. I did it anonymously because I'm a shy introvert. I wasn't looking for anything more than an outlet for my writing. It took off. It exploded. I was a real big critic of the mayor, and that wasn't good.
Go back to this.
This is Ravenstahl. Ravenstahl. Yeah. We are mortal enemies.
Yeah. So you say it took off, exploded. What was that about? Like?
I don't even know. I had 12 readers at one point.
Mm-hmm.
And then it's just the Post Gazette started picking up on things, and it just grew and grew and grew until I think, you know, each day. I wish I had my stack. I think I had about 30,000 readers. It was big.
Mm-hmm.
But I was anonymous, and a big thing was it drove people crazy.
Yeah, it was a whole search, especially when you start ruffling.
It was
because there was a lot of controversy. Like, you were ruffling big feathers.
Yeah, I had opinions, and I was anonymous. And being anonymous, yeah, you can say what you want to say.
Yeah. Yeah.
Which is awesome. I miss that.
It's a double-edged sword. It is awesome, man.
I miss it.
I wish people didn't know my face, because I would say so much more shit that I'm saying now. I say a lot of shit. Imagine if you didn't know my face.
That's scary. That's scary. But I feel like people made, like, there was a section of the population that took issue with his leadership, and they needed a leader, though. So you were outspoken about it, but they didn't have anyone that they can direct. Like, this is our lead. Like, this is the leader of our faction. Like, this is fuck this dude. You know what I mean?
You
like,
know, he became mayor.
Like that, but
I mean, I can't remember the number of votes, because however many votes he got to become a city councilman was, I mean, you know, Pittsburgh's voting record is trash.
Yeah.
So from those votes, then I want to say maybe 6 votes got him to be the president of council. Then Bob O'Connor died. So the amount of Pittsburghers that voted him to be mayor was less than 5,000. Because it was an interim election, wasn't it? It was bad. It was horrible.
Wasn't it like an interim election or something like that to happen? Because like he didn't.
For him to be mayor?
Yeah.
No, Bob O'Connor died, and the president becomes, this president of city council becomes mayor.
Oh, so he
just shit.
There wasn't even
fell
a vote.
Into
so
it.
He can't, yeah.
Oh, so he became mayor on 6 votes.
Basically, I mean, however many there are in city council, as long as you have the majority to become city council president, Bob O'Connor gets brain cancer. We are stuck with 25-year-old Luke Ravenstahl.
That's crazy.
Going on David Letterman. He's probably going to listen to this, but
that would be dope.
He never showed up to work. I mean, I had all these, you know, when you're anonymous, people just email you everything.
Yeah.
I knew everything.
Ooh,
so I knew he was not showing up to work.
That's crazy, because, like, I mean, I went through some recent beef or whatever, and I got people that were, like, off the record. Yeah, I mean, this is the shit that's going on. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, like, I ain't talking about the whole Carnegie shit that happened with Ben Owen or whatever online or whatever, but like on the podcast. But like, I got some like insider information. They were like, I don't want to lose my job over this, but this is some fuck shit. That's
going on. Well, in all walks of life, it's like that. There's an anonymous informant. There's a confidential informant for everything.
Yeah, I think that I feel like if you're doing something that's right, like somebody is going to be like, you know what, I fucks with you. I ain't going to be the motherfucker out here doing it, but I will support that cause. And that was just a one-time thing. I can't imagine the emails that you were getting.
Oh,
in
my
that,
God.
Like,
I know all the secrets.
That's
and
not all
I don't
world
share
is.
Them because then people will stop telling me the secrets.
Yeah.
But I know the secrets about everybody.
Respect that.
Everybody. I know the secrets. And so I knew not only how bad he was spending money. I mean, he spent $250,000 on 1,000 trash cans, with his name on them.
He was all over the fucking place. I remember walking down the street and just seeing, like, and that was a thing. Like, motherfuckers was talking like, yo, why the fuck is all, like, why are you spending money on trash cans for your name, bro? Like,
with his, you know, Luke Ravens all taking care of business.
I was in Pittsburgh.
Yeah.
Like, when he was in office, I was kind of still like, nah, I ain't from Pittsburgh. I ain't here. Like, so I really don't have the information as far as, like, what he was doing in office and everything. I wasn't paying attention at that point. But I've always heard negative reviews about, I didn't know he was buying these crazy
At the beginning,
things.
Everybody was like, oh.
Not even recycling.
Like, the youngest mayor and the whole nine. And
I remember
like, it was
that.
Like, oh, like, and I felt like, because I was around, I'm around the same age. So, like, when that was going on, I was like, oh, yeah, this is, like, you know what I mean? Like, oh, this is cool. Somebody that's, like, young like us is going to give me new, like, blood or whatever.
Right.
Da, da, da.
Well, you think he's going to be
that
progressive.
Hope. Yeah, and no.
No, he's a political family, you know? He's just going to stick with the status quo. He was just doing everything that he was told to do.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But eventually he got sick of it. He wasn't really working that much. I was a huge critic, and I could, because what was going to happen to me? Nothing. Because
he was out, like, he was out, like, events, like, not on some, like, I'm on some mayoral events. Like, he was out, like, partying, like, you know what I mean? Like, he...
Well, he was, what, 26?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
And
like,
I'm always here. I would just get emails, you know, guess who I saw doing, you know, at this place doing this. And I knew, because
I was in a club back in the day, and I would bump into a radio
that don't
star.
Make me
like,
fuck
so,
with
so,
him
like, I'd be like...
That would make me fuck with him a little more. Like, oh you coming but, to the phase
nah,
in Hollywood?
But this is on tax dollars, though. You I mean, balling on tax dollars.
Mean, but you kind of reinvesting in the community if you in the phase buying the chicken.
Bruh. Like, you can't be buying... You can't be popping bottles in the VIP, you know what I mean, on my tax dollars, bruh.
If you was 26, you ain't gonna pop at least one.
I would, but that's why I ain't mayor. So, man, if you want to buy bottles, you should not do it on my tax dollars. That's all I'm saying. Yeah,
I mean, like, there was photo proof. You know, it's not like that was a rumor. So that was something I was okay with addressing.
Yeah.
But not the other things that I was, you know, people just spill their guts to me to this day. All the time. You know, my Twitter DMs are crazy.
Listen, if you're listening to this and you came into the drinking partners through Virginia, feel free to hop in our DMs too. I'm just saying.
We like that. Yeah, my DMs are open.
Yeah, the DMs is open. Yeah, I mean, like, we could keep a secret.
I am the secret
keeper. Let us know. That's crazy.
So here's the crazy thing. It was a news anchor that discovered my identity. Yeah, and
investigative
and
journalism.
They came to me
Wait,
and
journalism
said,
still lives.
Right. And they came to you me and said, "Bad news. We figured out who you are."
How did they do that?
I was an idiot. There was one image on one of my headers that I linked to a really old photo bucket account. And I guess
photo
they were scouring
bucket.
The language on the back.
You got hit up with the photo bucket?
Photo what? Bucket.
God damn.
And it was my they first account,
deep.
And it was V. Montanez.
That's like getting
it's
caught on
Pittsburgh. How many Montanez's
and
are there?
Search
None.
Engine optimization.
I'm the only Montanez.
And you go,
so,
fuck.
So they got your last name right.
Do you know it? Right. They were like the Martinez's. Who do we know?
Damn,
no,
you got,
they got
caught
me.
On Friendster.
Wow.
She so got caught on Napster. She got caught with the oldest.
She had a Black Panther page. The ICQ. Like.
Well, actually, it was actually a local anchor had her friend in California figure it out. That's how much they wanted to figure it out.
Wow. You were ruffling feathers.
I was like, I was upset. I shut everything down. That day, I said, shut it all down. I didn't want anyone to know who I was.
Shut it down.
So that day,
you ain't
shut
want
it down.
You ain't want burly motherfuckers in black Chevys showing
well,
up.
Just, like,
it was definitely a hit out on
there
you.
Was yeah. a yeah,
they weren't gonna shoot you. They was just gonna throw Permani sandwiches at you. Pull up and throw a salami sandwich. Shut up, man.
But there was a reason I was anonymous. I did not want attention, so I said, "Yeah, shut it down." But I knew I was not going to be able to get away with it that long. Mm. Once the media knows who you are, then eventually they're going to tell. So I got out in front of it. I revealed my identity and I got fired from the next nonprofit, which was NEED, which is an African-American scholarship organization. They fired me because I was on the cover of CNN, which was terrible. It was bad because I got fired for what I wrote about the mayor. He released a press release saying, you know, we didn't think she needed to be fired, blah, blah, blah. But so that's kind of where my notoriety comes from, being fired for what I wrote about the mayor.
Now, what legal precedent can they use to... Yeah, I mean...
To this day, I am outspoken on my First Amendment rights were not violated. Because the government was saying, hey, she should not have been fired. That's Luke Ravenstahl.
Right.
A private enterprise, which was the nonprofit need, was saying, you know, even afterwards, my boss admitted, you know, he had a knee-jerk reaction. He probably shouldn't have fired me. Should have used what I could do to raise money for the organization. But no, to this day, so when Wendy Bell was fired and everyone was screaming about First Amendment, I was just like, no. Her First Amendment rights were not violated.
First Amendment comes with consequences.
Yes.
First Amendment. Yo, I lost 3 million impressions on Twitter a month because I spoke out. And, you know what I mean? And everybody was like, oh, you know, First Amendment. And I mean, like, you know, the whole Carnegie shit that happened. Like, I mean, they're like, oh, First Amendment. What do you mean? Like, you know, da 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 da. And it's like, look, man, like, right. First Amendment doesn't mean you get to say whatever fuck you want without any type of repercussion. Right. You can say whatever fuck you want. Right. And I get to say whatever fuck I want. As long as you're not persecuted by the government in order to do that, then, yeah, I mean, well, your First Amendment has been protected.
But in HR policy.
Nobody understands that.
So yours is a little different. So I'm looking at HR policy. And I deal with this daily. So
That's a private organization.
It reads, at least in my organization, and I don't know if in the need or the other organization. So basically, if you don't use the name of the organization in your profile, you've not breached any sort of contract that you have with them.
Right.
So that's where I'm interested with, like, okay, so you have these outspoken, you know,
right. Well, keep in mind that when this was happening, this was before social media, really. This was right when it was mostly blogs. Twitter was just starting.
Yeah, MySpace.
We didn't have a social media policy. There was nothing. I ended up writing it for them.
Yeah.
So later, you got a bag out of it. As a consultant. Yeah.
There's still some companies that don't have social media policies or whatever.
Well,
so,
you flipped it into a different bag. It's a different bag. I respect that. Like, you hustler. You a hustler. You a hustler, homie. You a hustler. She know that joke. She probably played that shit up all the way here. Like, now, I respect that because I mean, obviously, when you hear something like that, you immediately go First Amendment. But
I got a lot of
people don't read those policies.
Right. Now, I always knew there was a chance I would get fired. And when it happened, I was not angry. I was angry I got fired via text.
Don't that piss
that
you off?
That was a little bit wrong.
People do a lot of shit. People call off.
It was
fired you via text.
Via text.
That is some foul shit.
Everybody do shit via text.
That's some foul shit.
Yeah. So, again, this was, I don't know how many years ago, but I wasn't angry. I got fired because the way I put it was, if I was standing in front of their door shouting all these things about the mayor, I would be fired.
Yeah. And
so I just was using my words.
That's a very
mature
way to look at it.
I mean, I'm huge. I'm a huge proponent of the First Amendment. I'm also a huge proponent of consequences that come with that. As a comedian, I'm a very offensive motherfucker. I say motherfucker a lot. You know what I mean? So people don't like that shit. That's why I'm Dave Bracey. Don't nobody know my government name? I got a couple layers of government
names. That's why I'm Rico. That's why I do what
I
do.
Yeah, I got a couple layers of government name to keep that shit. When I got into this,
so
I was like,
dig.
Yeah, like, you got to dig. Like, if you Google Dave Bracey, you ain't about to find my shit or whatever. And that was, you know what I mean, understanding that shit going into it or whatever. But like I said, I mean, it, like, recently, like, in this issue that I had with Owen or whatever, like, I lost a lot of shit, but at the end of the day, like, it was worth it because I said what needed to be said. Now, I would like to shield myself from whatever repercussions, like, in a sense, you know what I mean? Like, whatever, and I don't blame I don't blame anybody left, right, whatever view you have.
Right.
If you're smart and you want to be outspoken, you should shield yourself. That's just, I mean, I'm always surprised at motherfuckers that just be out here, like, with they real name on Twitter, like and then be saying shit, and then get surprised when they get fired. It's
this motherfucker saying this,
especially now.
This nigga saying this, like, my Twitter name ain't Ed Bailey Comedy. Like
that's what
he's never advised me to change it.
But you ain't out here. Nah, yeah, I mean, the thing that it's a little different.
I am.
Like, you've always been very tactful in and, what
and here's
you
what
do.
It is. Yeah, it's not even tactful. Like tact. I'm just like, I'm not, so I'm of the opinion, and I would like to discuss this with you too.
Yeah.
So I'm of the opinion, I come from a place and I come from an environment where I don't really give a fuck about your opinion.
Mm.
You know what I mean? So I'm not so into getting into opinionated discussions online because I don't give a fuck about your opinion. Because I'm not going to sit here and be insulted by this motherfucker that ain't going to come see me with that same energy.
Yeah,
see, I'm right there. I'm straight to 12 with you when you pass a certain point. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
and like, wife will tell you, like, anybody who knows me will tell you, like, I am very calm. I'm very chill for the most part. Then once you cross the, it's over. Like, all right, now we there. Now I'm straight to 12. Like, okay, I don't necessarily. So that's why I don't engage in that regard. Yeah.
Online.
And it's not necessarily I'm nervous about my opinion. I just don't give a fuck about your opinion of my opinion on this because. Who the fuck are you?
Yeah.
Like, I'm not arguing with you. I'm not listening to you with your 67 followers calling me to end. Are you going to come see me?
Yeah.
So how do you navigate that? You know, with you, I mean, there was more support, I would assume. But you might get some negative.
I'm sure you had buckets of negative.
And it's just like. You know, I'm also assuming that when you were writing these pieces, you were like, this is rooted in rationale and it's supported by facts.
Right.
So if a motherfucker come in my DMs on some, you fuck you, you half Mexican, whatever they say, you just like,
anchor babies. I get anchor babies.
I'm
a lot.
Sure you got
anchor
a lot.
Baby.
God, anchor babies.
That's
a
new
lot.
One. I didn't
people
even
don't
know.
Even understand. I'm like,
I don't
okay,
know
no,
what the
I
fuck
am,
that means. It just sounds terrible.
I just, yo.
I get it. My kids get it. No, I mean, people are terrible. They've just been emboldened by social
don't
media behind their keyboards.
Like, got their chest all poked out.
I feel
out.
Hypocritical saying that because I was. Behind a keyboard, anonymous, saying things that, you know, I wasn't rude, but I was, like you said, I was stating facts.
Mm-hmm.
And people did not always want to hear them. But I got a lot of hilarious negative crap. My Twitter bio is a negative comment I got, which was when I spoke out against, what was it? The deer call in Mount Lebanon. I was like, deer are vermin, kill them.
They are a fucking road rat.
I was like,
fuck deer.
They need to go. They're going to kill somebody.
Fuck deer. Fuck okay, I'm gonna have
yo,
to. I'm
I lost.
Have to say
I lost
no.
two cars in a year from fucking deer.
I'm gonna have to
and
say
people,
no.
Fuck deer.
No.
What do you mean no?
Yo,
I
no,
lost.
Man, listen,
I totaled live. Two cars on
they
deer,
were
bro.
Doing it.
They people. The deer died.
They're not people. Listen.
But
let's
they're
be.
Human,
let's be. They're not people.
They're living.
They're
creatures.
Rodents.
They are.
So
but.
would you, if you had a rat in your house, would you kill it?
You know what?
If you had a rat in your house, would you kill it?
I've killed a rat before.
Yeah.
And I felt
that was my point.
So bad.
Oh, you felt so bad.
I felt so
bad. You didn't feel bad enough not to kill the motherfucker.
Okay, a snake.
I was
like, yeah, you're cute.
No.
If you're.
You wouldn't kill a rat, though? Would you kill a rat?
I've killed.
It, would you
not
kill
a rat.
Right now?
Thing.
Would right now, if you like saw
in,
a rat
in our studio?
In your house. No, not in your studio. In the house. If you were at home right now and you saw a rat. Would you kill that motherfucker? Would you
I
put
got
a,
kids.
A trap out? You
I wouldn't? Got kids.
What do you mean you got kids? That means you have to
that
kill it, right? Right?
That,
you
changes,
kill it.
That changes
you
the moral
kill it.
Compass.
No, it doesn't.
I have
it
children.
It doesn't. I got children, too. I got children.
The
trap
killed it.
I drive it in
the
my
trap
car
killed it.
With that fucking, with my children.
Here's the thing. If you put a trap out, no, you didn't kill it. His arm could have got caught in that trap. His tail could have got caught in that trap. It's
what?
How the rat
you know
approached
what?
The trap.
You know
look,
what?
That's God's
if I,
plan.
If I drop,
God's plan.
If I drop a bomb,
they wish
if
and
I
they
drop
wish
a bomb
and
on
they
your
wish.
City, it doesn't, like, I ain't kill you.
I ain't
the
drop a
trap no killed you. And you know
the
what?
Bomb
you just
that
happened
dropped.
To be in the area.
The bomb that you as, dropped killed him. There was just something on the floor that you ran into. Fam.
Nah.
I can't
right,
do nothing
nah,
with that.
Nah. They, you know what?
What if you backed into it?
You know what? You know what?
Like you'd have been all right.
You know what the equivalent to a mice trap is just happened to be there, is my motherfucking car two times in a row. They happened to be on the road at the same motherfucking time,
yes.
And my car hit that shit, and you know what? Like, fuck these motherfucking deer. Fuck deer.
I just, I don't
when
feel
when they're
the same
overrunning
way y'all
residential
feel.
Areas, which was the point in Mount Lebanon. You know, they were eating people's gardens.
Yeah.
Mount Lebanon wasn't having it. They were eating their gardens. But my point was, if it were snakes that were overrunning your neighborhood, you would want them to do something about it. So they came up with, I mean, I can't use the word humane, but I guess they were going to use a bow and arrow and just start taking some of them
that's
out.
That's no bueno.
By
that's
any means necessary.
That's what I don't
I'm
like.
I'm all about, I'm Bambi X out this month. By any means necessary, we Bambi, take these motherfuckers Bambi, out.
Okay,
if
so
we could lure them all into a spot and drop a motherfucking bomb on the midgets.
They were going to do, well, not a bomb. Genocide, they were going to bring them in.
They were going to lure them in and then just
shooting fish in the air.
That doesn't sound terrible.
I am for it.
Is there a fundraiser or is there a GoFundMe for the mass murder? Is there a GoFundMe for deer massacre? Because I will fund that shit. Yeah,
only
I mean
deer in residential. I mean, we're talking. Do you remember there was a time where it felt like they were just jumping through plate glass windows?
Yes. Yes. There
they
was like a string
like
of incidents.
Every week. It was like a deer jumped through the.
They owned this shit. They was just out there doing whatever. Were like, oh, nice donut shop. Would be a shame if somebody crashed through the window.
And
like, that's just...
There was no motherfucking donut shop before there was deer. We put that motherfucker where they used to live. Acting like they just showed up in this world. Like,
get down or lay down.
These are motherfucking animals that
was like,
here
before
you.
But,
fuck
but,
your donut
no,
shop.
Fuck
your
that.
Volkswagen. Like, the shit
no,
happened.
You
got to
get you gotta share. No, you got to.
You cannot
you
mass
gotta,
murder.
No, you got to share.
You're talking about the Holocaust and deer.
No,
why? Because
no,
they
you
don't
gotta,
know no better.
You
got
to share this space,
they
bro.
They don't get mortgages. Deers don't get mortgages. So they don't know what goes into this shit. Like, yes, I will say, I'm house hunting, and I was looking at a house that I really liked, and then I looked in the backyard, and there were deer. I did not buy that house. I didn't go kill the motherfucking deer.
Bruh, like, they also displaced other animals though and shit like the ecosystem.
You ain't killing them for no motherfucking animals.
The ecosystem is fucked up too.
Well,
you gotta get down or lay down out here, bro. Yeah, you know I mean. No, fuck that.
God damn.
They're not an endangered species. It'd be one
yeah,
thing if
so
they were like,
you.
It'd be one thing if it was
so
like,
what?
Oh, there's only few of them. They are rampant, cuz. There's
that
a lot
is
of them.
So much.
Like, nah, fuck
what
that.
That's what the cops
that's,
say
nah.
when they kill an innocent black man.
You know
he's
what?
Not an endangered
you're,
species.
You're not pro-black.
He's fucking up the ecosystem.
I'm gonna call you. You ain't pro black. Because if you was pro black, your answer to this would be we need to arm black motherfuckers to go out there and hunt for their food. Yeah, you know I mean,
have
that's
you
a
armed
the
deer? Have you talked about arming the deer?
No, I'm not talking about.
I've heard nothing about the
you
deer's
should,
empowerment.
You should be on some put a gun in every black man's hand to go out here and hunt food for them. Yeah, you know I mean, selves because. I mean,
I'm not pro gun in any situation.
No,
you know
I'm
what?
Not either. But
I'm not
I am pro driving down the street and not having a
and
deer
not have
jump
a fucking
in front
deer
of mine.
Fucking
even
not,
though
not totaling two goddamn
earth
cars in a year.
Existed with deer before y'all start driving down the street. That doesn't
but,
matter.
But no. I think
okay. I mean, that's no. cool. It's not
no.
a deal breaker as far as friendship.
Nah.
I'm just saying.
Nah.
You should never
nah.
be a pet owner.
Look, I
neither
like,
one
nah.
of y'all.
I know. I don't. I mean, I eat meat. I love venison.
That,
you know what I mean, I love the thing that they produce. But like,
son
look,
of
bro.
A bitch.
When it comes to animals, man, I don't have love for animals. That's
you're
just
saying
not,
that because they're cute.
No, I don't think they're cute. I don't think highly of them. They just
you
live.
Do think they're cute.
You think they're
because
adorable.
If they were ugly
they
as fuck,
cute.
You would exterminate them.
There's
how many
a whole
bugs
Disney
have you
movie
squashed?
About them? They're cute, but if they were snakes. Nobody would have said a word
not a
about
damn thing.
We're gonna go kill all the snakes in
yeah.
your neighborhood.
Nope. Everybody be like, you know, I'm about it. Spiders, let's get all the spiders.
Yeah.
Everybody be like, yeah, let's
we
get the spiders out. Yeah, you know I mean,
it's
daddy
I'm
long
not,
legs.
Okay. I'm not
all
really
those scary
into
shits.
Killing,
everybody loves scary killings
I'm not
the
really
scary
into
animals.
Killing spiders and ants, and I'm not really into that shit.
I mean, I don't.
I'm
if
just
it's,
not. They,
if we
they,
can,
they don't
here,
have no other way of life.
Here's my thing. I'm not killing animals that I can coexist with. So. I can coexist with spiders because they kill the motherfuckers that I don't like. I can coexist with, like a dog that like alerts me of this, that, and the other. Yeah, I mean, like if you got a job, but if you are a useless motherfucking animal,
well, what makes
only,
you so great?
Your only presence.
Well, what makes you so motherfucking great? What makes you so important? Because everything you're doing of importance is of import to you.
My frontal lobe.
What are you doing for the deer? What are you doing that makes their lives better?
That's evolution, bro. That's evolution. You either survive or fit. You either coexist or you kill each other. Those are the two options.
Those are your only two. If you had that same energy in all walks of life.
You either coexist or you murder each other.
That's a terrible outlook.
That's the outlook of what it is. And I try to push as much as I can for coexistence. I would love to try to coexist with these deer.
I would love to, but
year after year, they keep fucking running through my window shit, like my windshield. And that means that I tried. There's no diplomacy here.
And they weren't killing all of them. They were just trying to reduce the population.
I ain't trying to genocide you, bro.
Round them up.
Not all of them.
Not all of them. Just a portion.
So how are we gonna vet the roundupable deer? How are we vetting this?
Whichever ones was dumb enough to
fucking come. The ones that got the tattoos?
I don't know.
Whatever one saw the flyer for the deer party and came.
I will tell you, our goal was to make people like you more.
Well, you know what? I didn't say kill all the deer, but I feel like saying kill the deer.
No, I was going to say, I feel like you just gained so many more supporters out here.
Yeah.
I don't like deer. Like, I just won't kill them. But I won't kill them either.
I can't kill them. But I'm okay with...
I will fucking Rambo a deer. I'll do it with the severed... Yeah, I mean...
You've killed several deer.
I have. I've killed them, and I will do it again.
They're food.
I've smelled blood.
Eat them after you killed them?
I wish. They all ran off, though.
You know
they die somewhere else. They get hit.
I've never hit them enough to kill them.
They live a little bit, and then they run off, and then
you know
they die somewhere else.
After you kill it, you own that.
Because if I drive a sedan. So I'm saying if I would have hit them motherfuckers in an actual like truck and they died, oh, I would have definitely threw that motherfucker on the back end, took that little motherfucker to do the thing and shit. I'm eating for a year.
And I think these deer they were killing, they were gonna donate the meat to they were feeding people.
Imagine homestead. School district coming through with the venison burgers.
In homestead, school
summer programs.
Ain't nobody. Summer programs serving deer.
Summer program. All these kids ain't got no food in the summer programs. And you feeding them
with
venison
chocolate milk. It's not gonna happen. That folded pop chocolate milk. And you gonna serve me deer on the platter? With a folding pop?
If I was down at summer lunch and you gave me a deer burger and some motherfucking chocolate milk, I'd have been on that.
So I'm sorry.
This was supposed to be a Pittsburgh politics podcast.
What happened? That was it. Everyone lost their minds.
This was chaos.
I mean, I was getting insulted in some really interesting ways.
Yeah, that's beautiful.
So since then, I mean, how have you? So with your life, where's your career taking you?
After I revealed my identity, lost my job, Pittsburgh Magazine hired me to be their humor columnist. So that was awesome.
I do love your Twitter. I do love your sense of humor.
You are fucking spot on. But the point, I got to the point where I felt like I said everything I needed to say for the magazine. So I quit that. So now I'm writing a book.
That's huge, man.
Yeah,
like, I mean, I was like,
I gotta go out on top.
In comedy, you gotta go out on top or whatever. I look at like English. TV shows, like say The Office or whatever. Like most of these shows, they only have about like 1, 2, maybe 3 years, and then they cut. As opposed to like the English side, I mean the American side, that just goes ad nauseum
forever,
and then they're gonna be a reboot, and there's gonna be another, and then they're gonna. So, in comedy and like in my career or whatever, I'm looking at like, you know, in entertainment or whatever, like, it's like, man, you look at some motherfuckers, it's like, yo, you're past your prime, bro. Like, you know, you got to admit when it's done. That's a hard fucking thing to do because,
You know when you're pushing it. You know. You know when it's not easy. You know, like, I feel like I'm forcing this.
Yeah.
And I got to that point but and I shut
people,
it down.
Yeah, and most people won't shut that down. Well, that's what's like, crazy that you did that. So kudos to that. Like,
thank you. Yeah, it was important that I got out when I felt like I still, okay, that was a good thing to say, but I feel like this next one is not. I'm going to really be pushing it. So I quit that. So now I'm just, you know, kind of an opinionated, annoying person on Twitter that annoys people. So.
I mean, that's but like I you're still affecting change and whatnot.
No, yeah, I mean, and yeah, I'm doing what I can. You know, maybe at some point I'll get to the point where I want to do more long form writing about the city. But I'm cool with what I'm doing now. You know, I'm a mom, and I'm working on my own kind of writing now.
I'm sure our listeners, if you've listened to the podcast, you've heard me say it again, but moms, teachers, and nurses, by far the fucking most golden individual. Without those three, society collapses. So
right.
Yeah, don't just say, oh, yeah, I'm just a mom. No, you're not just a mom. You're a fucking mom.
No, it is a hard job. Yeah, but I mean.
Shit. I got raised by one. I wouldn't be here without it. Yeah, I mean, so, you know.
Forget the father.
Yeah.
If I, you know what, I do, man. Shout out to the father.
Because the Father's Day's coming up, man. I got to show love.
But even as a father?
It's not man, the no, as not a the, dad, you appreciate the mom more.
Yeah, I appreciate the mom so much more now that I'm a dad, yeah.
Can we just keep it real? Look, like, if you live in a situation where you have a matriarch, when she leaves the house, like for a week, you are lost.
Okay.
Oh, wifey, go out. Can she go I out on Friday? You? I'm calling her hundreds of times.
Yo, yo, cuz like you have to me and my BM split when we first, yeah, me and whatever. So like when I had my daughter, I didn't know like pulling in the ponytail, like hair care.
Oh, that's
like,
yeah.
Shit, like,
I don't even approach that.
There's a whole language. There's a language. I swear to God, there's a language that babies talk between like one and like three that I needed an interpreter for. Like, yeah, I mean, I had no fucking clue what they were saying. I would take her to my sister. I would take her to my mom. I would take her to my closest female friend and be like, "What the fuck is she saying?" Yeah, you know I mean,
so I can illustrate that perfectly. So raising my kids and everything, my son is 15 now, my daughter's 11. And for the first time, me and my four sisters decided to take a girls' trip. So we left all of our husbands alone with our kids.
Oh, y'all got mad phone calls.
Let me tell you about the text I got.
the first day.
Yeah. Okay, we're in California. We're in Palm Springs. So it's 4 in the morning. I get a text from my husband just to let me know that my daughter missed her bus. And he wants to know what school she goes to so he can drop her off.
Yeah.
Oh.
He was like, "What school did she go to?" And I was like, "This is a problem."
You do know you're not anonymous right now.
I have told everyone this story. I mean, I was like,
"Oh, he'll never live that down."
Hell no.
He had to know he was not living that down when he sent that. First of all, my daughter would have not gone to school that day. She'd have just missed school.
You know what? You know, he went through every motherfucking everything available to him.
All the paperwork.
He was digging into shit. He probably checked the fridge for like a letter or some shit.
He couldn't Google the school district. I'd have showed up. I'd have showed up at every school till they had my daughter on record.
I woke up at 4 in the morning and asked my text, like, "Wait, what school does she go to?" And I thought, this is a great illustration of the difference between everything a mom needs to know. And I'm not saying every dad doesn't know what kid, you know, what school their kid goes to. But yes, there's things that
generally know the school. We don't know what happens.
Yeah,
we don't know who the teachers are.
Yeah,
like my mom, she'll tell me about a teacher, and I'll be like, "Who is that?"
Yeah,
she's like, "Nah, you know, she with her every day." I'm like, "Nah, I didn't know that."
I'm a report card, motherfucker. Like I'm looking at the report cards, and I'm like,
"One, like once you know, then we know." That's how I like. Once you know, then we know. I don't have to ask. Like you know, we know. Like no, it's crazy. Here's how it normally happens. So the woman leaves the house. The first text we send, and it's just it's because we love you, like, "Yo, have you seen the remote?" that's the first one we send. We got it.
Yo, you know how many times I've sent the where the fuck? Because when I got the remote, I put it to where I know it's at.
There's a place right back for the remote.
So when I go for the where the place it was supposed to be at, I know you had some parts in it. So that's
No, well, we all got texts through the whole week. You know, just we knew what people, you know, they
y'all
just should
have documented that. That would have been a funny ass blog of just the things. And I've been working on, like, yo, I was telling wifey the other day, I was like, yo, when you leave, like, I'd really be lost.
Yeah.
And I don't want to admit it, but it's, I'm lost. Like, it's just right. all these small nuances that you just cover.
Right.
That you no longer cover and become a thing when you're
gone. It's like, and I can just what we do with comedy or whatever. Yeah, I mean, like, hosting is a different role from opening, is a different role from right. featuring, is a different role from headlining. You see what I'm saying? So while you're still parenting, you're still doing the same thing. You got different roles. You see what I'm saying? Right. And those nuances and those details that come in with being the mom and like all of that, like
just little stuff.
Yeah, I mean, yeah. like you could be a dope ass headliner and be fucking killing that shit. But when they tell you to headline, like to tell you to host a show, right. you're fucking lost. You're like, what the fuck? Like, cause yeah, right. I mean, you're doing headliner shit. And the same thing with the mom and dad. It's like, yeah, I mean, I'm a good dad. I'm the enforcer. I come in. Yeah, I mean, where's the grades at? You know, all that like dad shit.
Right.
But when you tell me to motherfucking like, you know, change a diaper or figure out the, you know, I mean, right. language or whatever, that's a whole, that's like, oh, and like the intuitiveness, not to, yeah, I mean, but I just feel there's that like, I don't know, like I said, women have always been, like, I'm giving jewels away, and I know, I mean, men might listen to this shit and be like, oh, you're giving it, but, like, bruh, women's intuition is, like, some real shit,
man.
No,
we've accepted that.
Yeah, women's intuition, no is like, yeah, that's a real...
We're done fighting that.
Yeah.
Any man who's been at home alone with the kids, he not fighting that.
Yeah.
Right.
It's these young pups with these relationships that ain't got no kid. They trying to act like they equal. You they ain't equal, know. Fam.
Yeah.
You don't know the new one. You don't know right. the ins and outs.
It's they like my fiance can feel. She'll be like, yo, I feel like, you know what I mean, they're, you know, da 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 da, like they're not on, like they're not acting the same way. I'm like, how the fuck?
Yeah, unless you know.
unless one of my daughters come up to me and be like,
yeah, you gotta tell me
some
what's
wild
wrong.
Shit. Unless there's some like very concrete ass,
you gotta tell me what's wrong.
I'm not gonna feel.
I'm not
what's
in
wrong.
The business of figuring not, you out.
Yeah.
I pay the bills in this
kids,
motherfucker.
Especially when they become teenagers, they do not want to say it. The only way I knew that my child was issues. Getting racism at school after Trump's election was his behavior.
Something
changed. And it wasn't like, mom, I'm having a bad day. It was just, you know, something
different. Something was off.
And it took me weeks to finally, you know, pull that out. Oh.
You got to be an investigative journalist for that. Like,
my child would have just been going through it. Because until you tell me, I'd just be like, you better fix your fucking attitude. You ain't paying no bills, Ryan. I wish you would come on with attitude. I ain't feeding you. Like, I ain't buy them clothes.
Yeah, and that's what the dad, like, I mean, at least for me, I feel like a part of being a dad is being the bad guy. You know what I mean? But also at the same time, like, because I am the bad guy in the house. That's just what my role is. Yeah, you know I mean, like, when.
I don't think we're the bad guy. I think we're more representative of society.
Well, yeah, exactly. But this that's the thing. But that's, but, well, but that's yeah. the thing, though. But in being representative of society, I get you, bro. I'm not saying like I'm on that same page, but what I'm saying is we're looked at like the bad guy. The kids are looking like, yeah, you know I mean? Like the
up.
Kids are gonna go to the mom first for some right. shit. Because if you ask
you
me,
you
I'm gonna be like,
one,
so what? How
treatment.
Is this gonna affect the future? Like, right. yeah, you know I mean, I'm
yeah,
all,
you come to me with some bullshit, I'm gonna be like, man, you better, man,
yeah,
my
yeah,
son,
like,
my
yeah.
son is one. He be crying, yeah. I'm like, man, you better sit your little ass down.
You gotta explain. If you cry, I'm gonna be like, why are you crying? I'm not gonna be like, oh, baby, tell
right.
me about
like,
you. I'm gonna be like, you gotta justify these tears.
Free meal eating ass. You was eating free meals crying. What you mad about?
Yeah.
Your life is good.
You gotta justify these tears to me.
We
yeah.
always father's parent from struggle.
Exactly.
We parent from struggle.
You gonna get this
like,
struggle.
You don't know what the fuck I went through today. I'm tired. My back hurt. My shoes is worn down. I got corns on my feet. You mad because the TV don't work. Man, you better sit your little dumb ass down. Better be happy you got cable. Watch whatever. Watch CNBC.
Yeah.
I don't give a fuck. Yeah, you're four. You don't know what they talking about. So what? It's cable.
I had five channels growing up. You know, and like, but that's the thing is that like kids need both. They need to have
they
that
do.
Understanding. You know what I'm right. saying? And like, you know, and because of that, like, and that's why every fucking person on the planet loves their mom more than like, because
don't
the dad,
they love their mama more?
Because the dad's the bad guy.
You fucks with your dad.
Yeah.
You fucks
yeah.
with your dad.
I think right. I feel like
you love mommy.
I feel like you don't appreciate your dad until you get older. because you don't understand. Yeah, you don't understand the lessons and all that hardship or whatever until you. Yeah, because it's just like
his flaws are on display too.
Yeah,
daddy's flaws are more on display, but that's a part of him teaching you too. Like I learned more from my father's flaws than I did just from direct. You do this in watching him as a man and watching how and dissecting it now as an adult. I understand the moves he made. I understand what he was going through. I learned a lot from that. I don't know what my mom did wrong. I know she did something wrong. Like, I have this feeling because she's I'm human. In a long-term relationship
we
that I'm like,
it.
I know you was getting on Pop's nerves. I know you was getting on
And that's
nerves.
What I'm saying. That's that maturity. You don't realize that until later when you be like, you know what? You probably was wilding a little bit. I ain't never see it. I never understood it.
I never felt it till now.
I know. You know what I mean?
You talk a lot, huh? You ask a whole lot of questions when daddy got home. Okay, I get you, Pops. I'm with you. Nah, it's cool. So how does that spill over into, you know, your writing and things like that? How much do you draw from personal experience? Not just opinion, but just personal experience.
You know what? I know they say you should write what you know, but if everybody wrote just what they knew, nobody could really be that prolific. I think it's more, someone said recently, it's more about having empathy. I don't really draw that much from, you know, my personal experience. Well, because I'm a very private person, you know.
I respect that.
I draw more from what I read than from what I experience.
But you do draw from your, because you're now... You're writing from the perspective of how you ingest what information you've gotten. So it's still personal in a sense.
Yeah.
And that's what's great. Like I like what you said because like you being a public figure. I mean, you're a public figure.
Yeah,
you
know, I don't know why, but
thousands of, you know what I mean, like you influence people or
you
whatever.
Took the mayor out. You,
and
you
to
took
be
on
a
the
public
mayor.
Person and also private. And people, I don't
it's
think
hard.
People get that. Yeah, you know I mean, so can you because I get accused of being, yeah, you know I mean, like you know,
yeah, school
so out there, like, yeah, you know I mean, but I'm like, but honestly, I feel like I'm a private person because like you only, and that's what, you see what I'm saying, but you only know what I give you. Yeah, you know I mean,
yes.
like you don't,
yes.
like when I'm going through like real shit, like, and
yes.
I, and like, and it wasn't until you went down really like and like before that I had is like, but like when you went
die.
When you went down, like when this mother was dead in the hospital, it was the first time that the two married, like it was like this is a personal situation, like this is my friend. Right,
right.
Like
that's
when
meaningful.
when my family has this, like the personal shit like that I go through, I don't post that shit online. You see what I'm saying?
Right.
Like so, in that sense, I'm a private person or whatever. And when he like had the accident or whatever, it was super weird because like I'm viewing it as a friend that's in a situation,
right.
but at the same time, I'm getting like the public asking and expecting answers for what's going on. And it was like,
and my wifey, she's not going to give you a lot of information.
Yeah, she,
you ain't getting a lot. Like, I'm not
none.
Public at all.
Shout
out to her for respecting my wishes because she was not giving, she wasn't letting nobody come up.
Yeah.
And she ain't think I wanted up in the hospital.
Everything was, I understand, like, and I understand as Ed, yeah, I mean, and their family, whatever, as being more private. So it's like, I was in a position where, like, like I said, one, I'm not the type of motherfucker that's going to tell you some shit. Motherfuckers are like, hey, what's going on? Da, da, da.
Right.
And I'm like, I don't know you, man. Right. I don't even know. Like, I don't even know you like that. Yeah, I mean, like, and then, you know, like having to, but you have to navigate it. You
well,
have to kind
the,
of.
The difference
so,
is that your audience doesn't know, and that I experienced, that they don't know that you're only really sharing 2% of yourself. They think that that's everything.
Yeah.
So they expect everything.
If you
and
think
when
you know
don't
somebody.
Give them everything, they demand it because they just assume we're sharing everything. So I ran into that too, where, you know, I don't have to tell you everything that's going on in my life. They're just assuming we already are. They don't know you're only
they
sharing
5%.
They just
assume they're getting invited to the motherfucking Christmas party this year.
Right. So that's the issue with fans. They don't... They overstep their bounds because they don't really know that we've put a threshold there on what we'll share. And that's when you run into people
so
showing up at your house. You know.
So what are some, say, some rules that you've put into place? Yeah, I mean, like, to, because the
well,
last...
Well, I don't share pictures of my kids.
Okay, so yeah.
You will not find, I mean...
Nice.
I never, if there's a picture of my child online, either it's my husband, but, you know, I encourage him to keep it private. But for me, you'll only see them from the back or at an angle that you cannot see their face.
Yeah.
Just because there are, I've gotten a lot of crazy stuff. So that was my, pretty much my biggest rule. I don't share anything about my teenage son, really, because he's getting to be at that age where he needs to determine
who he
but
is.
Other right. than that, it's, you know, I'm just playing it by ear like everyone else. I'm mostly just protecting my children.
Yeah, that's, and I kind of, I'm not, you know what I'm saying, where I'll share all types of pictures. I'm not in that situation. Because, you know, kid pictures get a lot of likes. Yeah. So, like, you can right. share, like, but I just,
I got
like,
dogs.
It's my kids, like, they don't have no control over this shit.
Yeah.
And I'm just putting pics of them out there all the time. Right. I'll put a couple, yeah, every now and again, I mean, because they're a huge part of my life, but I don't know how I feel about just sharing everything that I experience with them, because that's us.
Yeah, yeah.
Right.
No, you that's shouldn't. Thing, like. No, it's right. like, and it's crazy because like Facebook was my like domain. Yeah, you know I mean, it was like mm-hmm. and I share pictures with my daughter because like when I first got on Facebook, it was just friends and family.
You can control the
before,
privacy. Right.
Before I was a comedian, I used to try to keep my Facebook friends list under 200. Like it was like. If I got over 200, I was like, motherfuckers got to go.
Right.
That's all you can like, that's really, smart. You know what I mean? And that, and I kept such a hard, like, and then once I got into comedy, it like, I made a page so I can kind of like, so, okay, if you want to be a part of the Dave Bracy, the comedian, you
the
can do that,
page,
but
right.
this is still going to be my private thing.
Right.
And what happens is that like, it just, it got out of control. Like I can't. Now, like when I go to a show, they're going to see Dave Bracy, so they're just going to add me on the personal page, and they don't give a fuck about
yes.
it. So then, like, and I don't want to be a dickhead, so like I add them on it, and like, and I feel a certain way about like, you know what I mean, like, because it's the same page where I share my daughter's pictures, and I also am promoting my career, and that's a weird play.
Right.
So it's a different play, but I mean, at least with Facebook, there's a lot more. Checks and balances and a right. bit more control. I do not share pictures of my daughter on Twitter. Like,
oh,
yeah,
God,
I mean,
no.
like every once in a blue moon, like once, maybe twice a year, there will be a picture with me and her order, whatever. But outside of that, like motherfuckers that put pictures of their kids on Twitter all the time, I'm like, yo, this is the wolves, man. Twitter is the wolves.
Twitter is terrible.
They are the fucking wolves. And like Instagram, yes. saying like Instagram is such a like, you know what I mean? I don't do like that. Like Instagram and Twitter, like all that shit, like it's a, you know, like, but like, I feel like Facebook is one of those mediums that like, I kind of like, because like my family is there. Like all, like, that's how I keep in contact with my family. Even though that I've right. perverted it with, you know, like my comedy and like, you know, bringing in people or whatever, like that still is a way that I can contact with my family or whatever that's right. around the country. So they want to see those things. Yeah. You know I mean, so
yeah,
it's a blurry line.
It's like
line.
A newsletter. It's like your little family newsletter. That's yeah. understandable.
It's a blurry line with that. Right. But like, that is a thing. Like, you know what I mean, no kids out. Like I'm not putting my daughter out there to just,
yeah, you know that's mean? Pretty much my only big rule. And yeah. that's just me personally. You know, I try not to judge people that don't follow that rule. Public figures that are okay with putting their children out there, but I've just had too many experiences with some really awful people.
Yeah, I mean, you know, your introduction to the larger mass being a controversial sort of situation.
Yeah.
You know, you're kind of aligned with controversy, so with you being aligned with controversy, something that you yes. put out that might be cute, people feel empowered to just say some wild shit. And that's yes. why I'm a little hesitant. You know, I share some things. I got very... In my opinion, I got beautiful kids, right? You can't really you. Say nothing negative about them, but people will find. I ain't famous yeah. enough to where I got the people that will find a way.
Yeah.
Like people yes. will find a way yeah. to turn everything negative. Like I seen G Herbo. Like shout out to G Herbo. I listen to his music. He had a thing out where he was like kissing his son on the leg or whatever to show that his dog was overprotective. And somebody was like, "Oh, that's gay as fuck. You kissing your son on the leg? Like that's his fucking yeah. infant yeah. son. Like yeah. how can you turn that? How can you pervert yeah. that? Like it wasn't even
wolves.
About like it's out here crazy,
but
man.
Wolves.
Yeah.
So what fuck shit is going on right now in Pittsburgh that we need to know about?
Ooh, good.
Oh gosh. What you mean, like bad stuff?
Fuck shit.
Yeah.
Well, however you
fuck
interpret,
shit is generally negative. I will say, fuck
however
shit.
You interpret,
fuck shit. Fuck is shit. Generally negative.
What is going on that we need to know about?
I don't know that I know. Well, if I know anything I can share. like I said, I know all the secrets, but I know a lot. Every time something happens in the news, my DMs just go.
Yeah, like what's on your radar?
But the things that are driving me crazy, I'm worried about Amazon really hurting the city.
Yeah, Amazon should not be here.
Where are we with that? Like, are we still in it? Because I heard we were out of the running, but then I heard I asked someone recently.
I was in a conversation with someone that has more information than I do. They know things. And that individual said maybe 30% chance. So, and that person, I would trust their opinion. I just worry of what it's going to do to people that are already having housing issues.
Right.
I worry that it's going to just destroy the cost of living here, especially the cost of housing. So in Seattle, if you want a house that's under $500,000, you have to have a 2-hour one-way commute. Mm. $500,000 for your house, and you're going to drive 2 hours each way to Seattle. Now, my first house cost me $72,000, and it was 16 miles from the city.
Yeah.
So I am scared about that, and I'm hopeful that if Amazon does come here, that the mayor and the proposal indicated that we're going to expect some sort of concessions for housing. I look at East Liberty and I just... It's not good.
Do you really believe that?
I used to work in East Liberty.
Any proposal that was submitted to Amazon was going to benefit the city in any way? I mean, you got to look at what Amazon was doing, and they put it out to the country, and they were like, basically, bid and give us whatever. And when you look at the other proposals, has it become public yet?
Ours, no.
Okay, so...
if we get denied, I'm sure it will be, and then we'll really know. Because
I know there was in the process or whatever, like, I mean...
There's assumption. I think the public source guys are trying to...
But when you look at all the other proposals from other cities that are public, they were some fuck shit, bro. They were just basically like, yo, come in, rape us, and we'll be happy to put your logo on a building.
Just be here, damn it, man. Like, you know what I mean? Sit on my face.
It, like, so I can't... Yeah, exactly. Like, it was...
They're promising them the moon.
Exactly. Yeah. And any of those other proposals from other cities that I read about, none of those were really progressive for the hardworking people of that. The middle class, exactly. Yes. They were just like, we will let you do whatever the fuck you want if you come in and bring some taxes to us or whatever. I can't imagine with the secrecy that's around that proposal and them not letting that happen, that it would be anything that would be beneficial for the city, bro.
Well, we touched on it with Kalani from Black Tech.
Yeah.
Where she was saying, hey, if you're going to come in, you know, there has to be an investment into education or something in those communities.
In the community.
Have you heard any?
No, I have not heard anything. And so that's why I'm concerned. And okay, so recently the city, I want to say it was Seattle, they wanted Amazon to pay $232. That might not be the right number, but it was around $200 for each of their employees as sort of a tax that would go toward housing and for the homeless in Seattle. And Amazon was just dead set against that. So to me, knowing what Amazon is worth, $232,
they're going
to
be the first trillion-dollar company. And they're like, how many of the fucking employees are on welfare?
Every employee that goes to the city of Pittsburgh is being taxed $52. It's not.
Ain't that a bitch, that first $52? Come on.
So I got LSD tax.
That should be like LSD. It should be like LSD. Damn. I ain't buy that shit.
I got a 51 cent check from Eaton Park, my first job, because of that fucking tax, that city tax, bro.
It's already sort of a thing that happens, but Amazon was, you know, they're very against that. So that makes me nervous that if they're already against trying to help, you know, what are they going to do here?
Yeah.
Other people are of the mind, you know, just get them here and then we'll try to get what we want from them.
That's not how
what we want from anybody.
That's not how history is.
Not from UPMC, not from Pitt. We're not really getting what we want. So I'm a little nervous. I'm just kind of like a wait and see. If they come, I'll be happy, but I'm going to hope that they don't destroy the city.
If they come, you'll be happy?
I'll be happy that only because... I guess my view will be there's nothing we can do about it now. Mm. We just need to hope that it brings the jobs and that it does something for the middle class here. Mm. And then fight for it. Because you know me, I will be the person bitching about it.
Mm. So, who are some, know, some, I mean, because we in this election year, you know, midterms, you know what I mean? Like, you know, I mean, who are some of the folks maybe you like, you know?
Well, so here's the thing about me. And I think most of my readers know this. I was raised as a Republican.
Yeah.
I was. And I had some really wrong ideas.
Yeah.
And so
I
for that.
I was raised as a Christian.
Right. Yeah. And now I'm, you know, I had a Conor Lamb sign in my yard. And I have just gone completely the other way. I feel educated now. And I'm.
That's
so
a beautiful thing. Education is a beautiful thing.
I think, you know, when I was raised, and I was raised, you know, white, middle class, it was just like, you're going to be a Republican. It was just given to you. This is who you are. This is what you're going to believe. And as an adult, married to a Mexican with biracial children and working for minority nonprofits for 12 years, I've been educated. So I'm pretty much a Democrat now. It's probably... I'm that's what I'm supporting. That's the.
I think, just to kind of, like, I feel like, I mean, like, you're left leaning. Yeah, I mean, because Democrat is becoming such a.
I'm sort of.
It's becoming such a. Yeah. It's becoming such a, like, middle ground. Like,
right.
They're just trying to win elections at this point. So you get all these, like, like conservatives that are, like, rebranding themselves because
that's a good
conservative, like, because a Republican these days is Nazi, so they're like, you know what, I'm not a Nazi, so I'm a Democrat. And you're like, when you make when the right becomes so extreme, the middle moves. So now a middle, what used to be a middle,
we need a new
20
party.
Years ago, is now like a left. You
right.
See what I'm saying?
Yes,
like,
exactly.
What
I've
used to be right is now the middle. Like, yeah, I mean, like, oh, like, yeah. there was an advisor or whatever. Like, I mean, like, with the he was part of the Bush administration.
Fleischer?
Was that his? I mean,
it could have been. He's pretty right leaning though.
He just like announced that he was running on a Democratic ticket.
Oh, I didn't know.
For the election, because he's not agreeing with the new way that the Republican Party is going.
Yeah.
And when they say that, when all these, like, when they say the Republican Party, like, I don't agree with the Republican Party, what they're saying is, I don't agree with Nazis, and I want to distance myself from Nazis. But that doesn't mean that you're a liberal. It doesn't mean that you're left. It just means you're not
a Nazi.
Right
anymore.
So, like, the new left, I don't want the new left to be... Well, I don't want to gas motherfuckers.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, like, that can't be the, all right, now I'm above, like, you got to have a little bit more. How do you feel about universal healthcare? How do you feel about, you know what I'm saying? Like, the actual left shit that we, And it's crazy because what used to be left is now starting to look like an extreme. Just because decency for humans is now like, oh shit, you're all the way over there.
Yes,
that's so
you're a
different. Yeah, you're
you
a snowflake.
Care.
Yeah, I mean,
that
because
word
you don't want to mass execute people. Like, yeah, I mean, like, or because, you know, like, children are dying in schools, and we're like, you know what? Maybe we should have less guns. They're like, fucking snowflake.
I mean,
liberal.
I am completely for gun control. And that's every time I put something out there about it, you know, sensible. Tide pods, kids get Tide pods, we make it harder to get them.
Yeah.
Kids get shot in school and we're not making it any harder.
Yeah.
I don't understand that.
And like I'm not anti-gun. Like, I grew up in a culture of guns.
Me either.
Like, you know,
anti-gun.
Everybody that I knew I grew up with, they had guns or whatever. I knew kids that took guns to school.
I
grew up like
I knew
like
kids
I've been trained with the gun or whatever. Yeah, I mean, but like it's a different culture, you know what I mean, like in the black community than it is in this, like, I mean, in this mass shooting community. When you look at that, because like the black community ain't out here like running into schools and just murdering motherfuckers that they don't know for no reason, whatever. Yeah, it's more protection.
Yes.
It's because you're in a, you know, I mean, a lifestyle, whatever. I mean, da da da. Like with the white like community or whatever, like
they're
it's
just
heavy.
Hoarding guns.
They're hoarding guns because they think the government
and they
think the government and the Browns are coming for them.
It's
you
for
see what
power.
I'm saying?
Yes, it's like, an invasion.
It's an invasion. Like if I got a gun, I got a gun in case a motherfucker runs up on me.
Right.
I ain't got a gun in case fucking Bush runs up on me, because this gun ain't gonna fucking protect me against Bush. We know that in the black community. We know this motherfucking AR, whatever. Right. Like, I mean, whatever this 9, this 45, whatever, that's not going to stop the cops. The right. cops got way more men and guns than we do. Yes. We ain't buying this shit so we can, like, because we got angst and, like,
then you would be doing what, you know, you'd be having a militia. You would be arming yourself to the teeth.
Yeah.
You're not. And so that's the issue. It's just sensible. You know, how many guns does a person really need?
So, you know, none. But like I said,
anti-gun pro the fair one. Give me the fair.
Oh, the fair. Yeah, give me the fair. Always. I would love the fair one.
I'm anti-gun pro the fair one.
But given the environment, you know what I mean, like, and what it is, it is so mixed. Who are some of the folks that, like, you're rallying behind?
Who are some of the folks that what?
That you're rallying behind that night. Well, I mean, you're giving some.
I was a big Conor Lamb fan. Yeah. I am honestly for anyone who is going up against the far right, you know, or the establishment. So, you know, I was kind of happy to see the Costa brothers go, or cousins.
There's a lot of
I was
Costas
really
out
happy
there,
to see. They're
yeah.
establishment.
Man, Costas out there.
They're,
yeah.
they're not.
Those dynasty families.
And I was so happy to see who beat them.
Yeah.
You know, I just want some change. I want some diversity. And I really, really, really want Metcalf gone. Daryl Metcalf. He needs to go.
Yeah, that was a whole city
Anybody
paper.
But
city
him.
Paper. City paper, you fucking up, bro.
Yeah.
City paper, you fucking up, B.
He's a terrible person.
I have, being from Cleveland, I have an affinity to the name Metcalf because we had Eric Metcalf. He was so diverse.
Yeah. No.
On the football field, but yeah, I mean, I'm not.
City paper, you fucking up, B. Like, you about to, yeah, you know I mean, because that was like the bastion of like the left in Pittsburgh. Like, that was like, I mean, you had expected that. We've gotten a lot of love. We've won Best of the Berg and whatnot.
Right.
You know what I mean, we got our, there's always been a lot of support with a lot of the shit that I've been going through over the last year with the Zach Hudaks and the Owen Benjamins or whatever. I've gotten a lot of support from that, you know what I mean? But at the same time, I am not a closed-minded, like, you know what I mean, jump on the bandwagon type dude. If you fucking up, I'm going to tell you. And I'm only telling you fucking up because I fucks with you. You see what I'm saying? So, like, City Paper is fucking up. But, like, what are some of the, I guess, if you were to say the top three issues right now looking at a candidate.
Locally?
What are the three, locally or nationally, however, well, like, politics-wise, what are the three, like, issues that you're looking at in a candidate?
Easily, it is, I need someone who is more sensible on immigration.
Immigration.
There's just no way to kick 11 million people out of the country, and there's no way to do it. But also, it would have horrible economic problems for us.
Yeah.
And also, people can't find labor now. Was it in Pittsburgh? I can't remember. It was a landscaper shut down. They had been there for 60 years.
The food industry is shut down.
Because the administration stopped the seasonal workers visa. They really, so immigration is, I'm not saying amnesty. I don't know what I'm saying. I don't know what the fix is, but
that's
a wall is not going to do anything.
Yeah.
So that's one of the reasons that I'm very against Metcalf and why I was against Rick Saccone. You know, their view was just, if you cross that border, we don't want you here. If you look different, we don't want you here. It just doesn't make any sense to me.
I think there needs to be more room for that in what you just expressed. But I don't know the answer.
Yeah,
I know that this is a problem.
Yeah.
And I think that's, people use that against, like, all right, so what's the answer? Oh, you don't have an answer? All right, so
Nobody knows.
We need to identify and work towards a solution.
Right.
So, and I think that, you know, for this podcast, because I think I try to theme each podcast, but this is find a solution for this one. Like, find a solution. Like, be outspoken, find a solution.
Right.
Like, talk about that shit. Like, there's nothing wrong with speaking out. There's nothing wrong with expressing your opinion. You might get fired. That's cool. You know what I mean? You'll find your way.
Like, right.
And a lot of people, when they're fired or when they're laid off, they do find, I found that, like, a lot of people, they get laid off and then they get to pursue their passion.
Man, bro.
They find the thing they
genuinely love. I wouldn't be a comedian unless I got fired from like 50 other jobs.
Get fired from.
Yeah. So what are the
other
two?
So that's two. I would have to say the third one is locally, more transportation probably, infrastructure, that sort of thing.
Pothole infrastructure.
Right. Because, you know, it's just falling apart.
Marita Garrett.
Yeah.
She fixed that.
She said.
What was happening? So this city that you're getting all four seasons,
do want to say, though, I was at an event a couple of days ago, and somebody put up the, I mean, they were like, you know, like that row between like Whole Foods or whatever. Yeah, you know what I mean, it's always good and shit like that. So it's like, you know, the material though. Like, I mean, these potholes and the infrastructure or whatever.
Right.
Like, it's like, because you look at fucking Japan and China, and like they have a whole bridge collapse. And a whole fucking, like, I mean, there's a hole in their whole city. And then 2 days later, it's fixed. It's 2 days later, it's fixed.
And I remember that.
I've been driving past the same stretch of road every year for fucking 5 years. And you still doing this shit, bro?
Right.
For like 4 or 5 months out of the year, you still working on the same patch of road, bro? And over there, I mean, that's corruption. I was like, I mean, when you talk about the potholes or whatever.
Yep.
There's a like a company out in like over, was next to Highland Park Bridge out there in East Liberty, East End, or whatever. All that, you know how you get bound in, like, but Highland Park Bridge, all that shit over there, whatever. There's a company down there, and the city is owed to that company. So, like, a lot of the new materials that maybe come out ain't really coming out or whatever. But, like, you have the technology to make this a thing. You don't have to be working. Like, how many times have you driven by and ain't not a motherfucker out there working?
Yes.
But for some reason, traffic is backed up. For like, you know what I mean? And that's the thing, is that like, you look at any up and coming city, any growing city, any city, whatever, the roadways are the blood to a city. If you can't get products, goods, and services in and out of a city, that shit will die just like a heart. If you can't get blood into your heart, it'll die. If you can't get people in and out of your fucking like city, it'll die.
That is one of the things I think that Amazon will look at. And I think that might be the thing that makes them say no. Because it's just impossible.
You can. And because I mean, I understand the topography or whatever is the fact that we are three rivers or whatever. Everything goes through a tunnel or a river. But at the same time, if you like, when you look at this summer shit, you do not have to close down a whole section of road and then not work on it for 12 hours. Yeah, I mean, like, you're gonna close down this.
It's perfectly good. Like, why can't I drive on that?
Like, why am I, like, why? Nobody's working here.
Right.
There's no reason for this shit to be closed. There's no, why is it here? And that's what I'm saying, is that, like, you look at, I watched, like, I'm out in Beaver, and there's that cracker plant coming up. I watched private organizations build entire roads that weren't, they took down a whole mountain. There used to be a mountain. They completely demolished that mountain and built new roads in the same time that it took them to paint a bridge. To paint a bridge.
Paint it, yeah.
For the public, you see what I'm saying? So I don't think, like, when you say infrastructure, I understand. I appreciate the fact that they're putting money into infrastructure, but I do believe that it needs to be more efficient. I believe that PennDOT, there's a lot of corruption going on in that organization.
Well, yeah.
And it fucks with us negatively.
Right. Yeah, in the state, you know, PennDOT, the Turnpike Commission, and the PLCB, they all need to go.
Damn.
Yeah, they all, it's just corrupt.
Gotta go.
Yeah.
Yeah, so I've been outspoken about that. Everyone knows that I just, you know.
Fuck, hashtag, if you listen to this, fuck, hashtag fuck PennDOT. You know what I mean?
I guess. I guess I'm left to deal with that, the hashtag fuck PennDOT. But go ahead, I don't take it, but yeah. So listen. In the vein of gotta go, we've been here, we've been talking, we do gotta go. Let the people know where they can find you.
Well, I'm mostly I'm on Twitter, so I'm Jane Pitt, which is just a dumb name I picked. I'm Jane Pitt. I shut down my Facebook recently, which has been great. I highly recommend it.
Yeah.
So that's pretty much the only place right now that I'm, you know, I have a Medium that I use, my blog that I'll write like once a year in, but right now, I'm mostly just writing my own stuff at home. But I'm on Twitter a lot.
So, at Jane Pitt?
Jane Pitt.
And
I got mistaken for Brad Pitt's mom once. It was bad.
Yeah. Isn't it wrong?
Because she came out like with some sort of really conservative view. Mm. A really bad one. Mm. And I got some hate. Yeah. People just assume, I'm like, do I look like I could be Brad Pitt's mother?
We don't know in this America. This America, we don't know who's related to
her. Just like, please look at my picture before you start yelling at me. But Jane Pitt, yeah.
All right, Jane Pitt, let the people know where they can find us.
If you're looking for us, you can find us on epicastnetwork.com/partnerspod. You can find us on IT. Oh, shit. You can find us on IG, Twitter, and Facebook at Partners Pod. You can find us on iTunes, Stitcher, Libsyn, and Google Play under Drink Partners. And you know what? I just had a guy come up to me, and he told me that he listens to all the podcasts on YouTube. So you can also find us on YouTube. Shout out to Epicast, man.
God damn.
Puyo, Epicast puts us every. If you're looking for us, Epicast, make sure that you can motherfucking find us. So, yeah, we also are on YouTube. You know what I mean? Like, shout out to them and shout out to old boy for putting me deep with that.
Yeah, man. We want to thank our guest today, Virginia Montanez.
Montanez.
I say Montanez. We Americanized it.
Montanez. Yeah.
We got rid of the Nye.
Can I afford Montanez?
Montanez. It sounds
Montanez. French. Montanez. Like, I'll fucking turn that to a whole
other. You got to throw like a handkerchief or some shit. That's like what when I'm you saying, say it. Like, Montanez. Montanez. Like, you got to have a rose in between.
Like,
your
y'all
teeth.
Like the Montauks from fucking Romeo and Juliet and shit. But no, we want to thank you for coming out, man. Very enlightening conversation. You know what I'm saying? And invest in your city. Invest in what's going on. Educate yourself, man. Like, educate yourself. That's real shit out here because there's a lot of shit going on that you don't understand that's really affecting you day to day. And we feel privileged to be able to bring some of that to your consciousness. So, as always, Drinking Partners is the crew. Epicast is the family. And we out of here.
You ever heard of the broadcast? Yeah, they were on our podcast last year.
Oh, the broadcast.
Yeah, remember that? Yeah. Oh, no, wait, I think you were still. Wait, no.
No.
That was the year before that.
Vince Vega?
Yeah, Vince Vega.
I've seen her all the time. She's coming into my job all the time.
Well, this was worth my
time. Well, thank you. You know how to keep secrets.
Are they still doing that?
Yeah, they're still doing it. Yeah.